First of all, I'd like to thank Nira for having me here to speak today. I'd also like to thank everyone present for being here and participating in what I think is the discovery of a really amazing, newly discovered site in Pennsylvania. Nira has been an integral part of this site, the discovery, since 2007. I'd personally like to thank Polly Midgley and Fred Martin for their help with the site at that time. And I'd like to thank Larry Mulligan for his help and support this past year. I'd like to put it right out front that this project I call Council Rock Mountain is one long, mysterious journey that never ceases to amaze me. It's been a journey of synchronistic and unplanned events, not unlike the film Field of Dreams by Kevin Costner. I was drawn to this property in 2004 and purchased it in early 2005 without really even shopping for land or having the money to buy it. Everything just made itself available synchronistically. So I went with my gut feelings. I bought the land, I hiked on it, and I fell in love with it. I camped with my girlfriend at the time, Kelly, and her daughter. I picked blueberries, and I came to have a special attraction to this high meadow with a great view and four large boulders. The boulders are indeed very large. By their dimensions, I estimate they weigh from 15 to 30 tons each. In my mind, I imagine that this must have been a special place for the Native Americans who lived in this area. I thought it would have been a great place to hold council meetings. And so, I call the rocks Council Rocks. In the beginning, I thought they were maybe glacial erratics, large boulders that are dropped from a glacier as it melts. Originally, I thought their placement was random, though intriguing. I thought I could see shapes in the boulders, animal shapes. On my second visit to the property, even before purchasing it, my friend Nancy came with me, and we tried to imagine what each of them might be. The first one was kind of obvious. It looks like a giant cat's head when seen from the side. Looking at the western side of the stone, you can imagine a nose off to the right, the eyes a little bit above it, and a feline ear up at the top and to the left. It also looks very old and weathered, like it's been there a long, long time. From the other side, it looks even more sleek and cat-like. The surface of this side is fresher, as though the stone was more recently cut with tools of some sort. The nose is still out in front, and you can see hints of nostrils or a jawline. The eye is even more defined, but the ear is missing or pulled back. There's also a strange right-angled cut to the far right. My friend Kelly thought the cut looked like a turtle's open mouth, and she still calls this the turtle stone. The stone is about 7 feet high and has a circumference of 26.5 feet. It's probably the heaviest, and I estimate it at about 25 to 30 tons. For those of you familiar with dolmens, this cat stone is resting on other stones and not on the bedrock itself. The second one is kind of hard to figure out. It's in two pieces, likely because of centuries of freeze-thaw cycles. Water gets into the cracks, freezes, and pries the stone apart over time. I'd love to put it back together, but it's too heavy to lift. If it were together, it would probably be about 6 feet high and 6 feet wide, and about 12 feet long. It probably weighs 20 to 25 tons. The portion that slid off, the western side, has a curious projection that's almost a platform of some sort. If the stone were back together, that platform would pretty much be parallel to the ground and would make a nice seat or a place to stand. The eastern side is fairly flat, but has some grooves cut up toward the left side. They remind me of gills on a fish, so I call this the whale stone. The front end of it seems to have two pieces that have fractured off the nose, and they're lying on the ground right nearby. I haven't moved them at all because I don't want to disturb the site too much. The third stone, to me, is most definitely a seated bird, most likely a falcon, hawk, eagle, or some other raptor. My friend Nancy said it looked to her like a crone or an old woman. Now, from this western side, we both agreed that the head is on the upper right, but what she saw as a shawl, I saw as a bird's folded wing. The lichens growing on the rock only add to a feathered effect. The head is really interesting because the neckline is smooth and the beak just juts out. On the eastern side is a piece that's detached, which is lying on the ground. Again, it's too heavy to lift, but I imagine it as the other wing. To the rear is a disconnected tail piece. I didn't notice this the first day, but on another visit, I noticed how the front of this disconnected piece would mate perfectly with a hollow space at the back of the birdstone. It also comes to a point which would complete a perfectly symmetrical bird shape. In addition, I just noticed this past year a perfectly cut groove that starts at the bird's brow line and runs back to a point above the tail and then completely back up the other side into the face. It doesn't look like the random work of a glacier. This stone is 6.5 feet high and has a 21-foot circumference at the base. I'm guessing it might be 15 tons. The fourth stone in the center of the meadow I call the altar stone. While it doesn't look like an animal to my eyes, its placement is obviously special and it has a flat top. The stone is 5 feet high, 5 feet wide, and 10 feet long. It's probably close to 20 tons. I hiked this land and then I enjoyed these council rocks for 2.5 years before a customer of mine, I was a postmaster at the time, came into my post office with a book called New England's Ancient Mysteries by Robert Cahill. This customer and friend of mine, Joe Boyle, told me he had just been to Stonehenge of the Americas here in New Hampshire and that he'd bought the book there. As I looked through it, I came to page 31 and saw a photo of the Cat Head Dolmen in North Salem, New York. I immediately recognized the likeness to my own Cat Head Dolmen. I shared with Joe a photo of my stone and he lent me his book. I found a reference to Nera in the book, and within a day or two, I was on the Nera website. I emailed someone to let them know I had a similar stone on my property. That person put me in touch with Polly Midgley. Polly emailed and requested some more photos. She then forwarded my photos to Fred Martin, who wrote back and asked whether my stones aligned with the winter solstice sunset. I told him that I had no clue. Fred suggested I look through the curve on the birdstone's neck and past the point of the cat's nose. It was October of 2007, not quite yet solstice time, but I could see that the sunset was close, just off to the right, and I knew it would be moving to the left daily. It was also the first time I noticed how closely aligned these three stones were. I had thought they were in a slight curve, but as you can see in this photo, you could lay a string across the front of the stones and it would touch all three. Again, not something a random drop from a glacier would do. I anxiously awaited the winter solstice. Unfortunately, the weather was cloudy a week before through 10 days after. It wasn't until New Year's Eve, December 31st, 2007, that I was able to get a photograph of the sunset. On that day, I was blown away by what I saw. You can see in this actual photograph from that afternoon that the sun set perfectly on the nose of the cat as seen through the neck of the bird. As above, so below. These animal-shaped stones representing earth, water, and sky were set up to track the movement of the sun. I took many photographs that day and over several more days until I had a pretty good collection with which to work. I've been an amateur astronomer for almost 30 years and knew that I could use the photographs to do some very accurate positioning of the sun's location over time. There's a term in astronomy called ephemeris, which comes from the Greek word for diary. Basically, an ephemeris is a mathematical table that can accurately predict the precise location of any celestial object in relation to a specific location on Earth. It can be generated on any properly programmed computer. Since I knew the precise location where the photographs were taken, and I knew the exact date and time from the timestamp in my camera, I knew I could also find out exactly where the sun was for each of these photographs. The ephemeris chart I used is located on the internet at NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab in Pasadena, California. It's accurate to within 1/10,000th of a degree. But I knew that the sun didn't always set there. My perfectly positioned photograph was actually taken 10 days past winter solstice. The ephemeris data I found told me that if I had taken the photo right on winter solstice that year, the sun would have set 0.5 degree to the left of the marker. The Earth wobbles on its axis in a very predictable way, similar to the way a spinning top wobbles as it's slowing down. It takes about 24,000 years for the Earth to complete one wobble. Fortunately, that same steady, predictable movement lets us know where the sun would set on solstice of any given year. Since I had a photo of the sun in perfect position on the marker, I could use the ephemeris tables to find the exact position in azimuth and altitude, which is degrees from true north and degrees above or below the horizon, with that photograph. The position was 238.4426 degrees west and 0.1334 degrees above the horizon. I then went back a few years, and then a century or two, to see when the sun had set at that position on winter solstice. I had to back up a lot farther than I thought. Eventually, I was able to come up with the exact year when the sun would have set perfectly in this marker on the precise date of winter solstice. That year was 1825 BCE, almost 4,000 years ago. As you can imagine, I was really moved by this discovery. A piece of land that had called out to me and arranged for its purchase had on it a Stonehenge of sorts that was likely constructed almost 4,000 years ago. How could this be, and who could have built it? I began to wonder if there were other aspects of the stones that I was missing. A gut feeling drew me to one of the stones in particular. Do you recall that right-angled cut in the Cathead dolmen? That's the piece that called to me. I went to Council Rocks again and had a better look at that cut. Something made me relate it to the altar stone. I backed up and noticed that when I stood outside the circle and looked through that cut, that the shape of the altar stone fit nicely into the cut. I also noticed that if I stood in just the right place, the altar stone fit exactly into the cut, leaving just a small triangle of space in the upper right corner. I imagined the sun shining through that triangular space. I took a compass reading on that line of sight and went home with my notes. It was several weeks later when I took the notes out to have a look at the NASA website, about 1 a.m. one late night as I remember, when even a preliminary look told me that the spring sunrise would be in this approximate direction, I was awestruck. Although I hadn't measured this one yet photographically, it seemed as all these gut feelings were coming together and proving true. And so I waited for spring equinox. I didn't really have a clue as to what date to use, so I just shot for the first sunny morning. That happened on March 23rd, 2008. I got a series of photos of the sun rising a little to the left of the altar stone and moving diagonally right. The sun missed the corner, but came into the horizontal opening just left of it. A week later, on the 30th, I was able to get another series of photos, but the sun was moving farther away from the corner. Still, the information I had gained was valuable. Using a similar system to determine the sun's position at solstice, I plugged in the dates, times, and location of each photo on NASA's ephemeris calculator and printed a grid overlaying the actual photos. From that grid, I was able to determine an approximate location in azimuth and altitude for that corner space. As you can see in my handwritten notes, my estimation was for 103 degrees east and 12.6 degrees above the horizon. Now all I had to do was use those same tables to determine when the sun would be there again. The first return would be near the time of the autumnal equinox. Most unfortunately, morning clouds blocked all photos that fall. The sighting mechanism is much more precise than the winter solstice open sights. It's very precise and small opening, and I had to wait until spring of 2009. The charts told me that the sun should be in or near that opening on March 17, 2009, at 8:22 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time. They also indicated the sun would graze the lower left of the altar stone at about 7:45 a.m. Both predictions were right on. I got some great photos that year, and was able to use them to refine the line of sight position cut into the stone. Remember that March 17th is a few days off from the actual equinox date of March 21st. But with the photographic information and precise positioning, I was able to go back in time using the JPL website and find out when the sun would have been there on the exact equinox date. That year turned out to be 125 BCE, or approximately 2,135 years ago. I was a little disappointed at first that the dates didn't match, but I remembered how the face of the cat stone appeared to be more recently cut. It's much less weathered than all the other surfaces on any of the four stones. It's possible that this particular equinox marker was cut at a later date, 1,700 years later than the earlier construction of the site. Perhaps an earlier equinox marker was no longer accurate. Perhaps it just had to be recut. No matter what, I'm baffled as to what tools might have been used to make such an accurate and clean cut over 2,000 years ago. I do believe I have a fragment of the material removed to make that cut, but that's another story. There are other alignments I'd like to present, particularly the summer solstice sunset from what I call the grotto, about 500 yards downhill from Council Rocks. Underground springs carry water which can be heard flowing beneath the grotto in rainy seasons. I often wonder if any of these springs have formed caves. A line of small boulders at the grotto points to a large stone on a ridge half a mile away. I found this alignment using a compass and a satellite photo that pointed to a sharp turn in a trail on a nearby ridge. There's a large prominent stone right where the trail turns. Both are lined up perfectly for a summer solstice sunset, also in the year 1825 BCE. I don't have enough time to squeeze everything in here today, but this feature is a study in itself. Here's a photo of the grotto at summer solstice sunset. I would like to mention one of the most important aspects of my work to date on this site. As anyone delving into this field of research knows, credentialed archaeologists don't even want to hear about archaeoastronomy sites in North America. As far as the academic community is concerned, there can be no archaeoastronomy sites on this continent because Europeans didn't arrive until Christopher Columbus got here in 1492. Well, about a year ago, on April 8th to 10th, 2011, I registered for and attended a conference of professional archaeologists in Morgantown, PA. It was the annual meeting of the Society for Pennsylvania Archaeology. I was hoping to make at least one contact or connection that would help to validate this site. Of course, I was warned in advance by the person who took my phone call to register that this was not a popular subject amongst the professionals. I heeded her advice and decided not to speak too much, but I did take a portfolio of photographs with me. On the first day of the conference, I ventured a few words here and there whenever someone asked who I worked for or why I was there. It generally didn't go well when I explained I was an amateur working on an archaeoastronomy site. One person was even genuinely rude, turning away from me as we spoke. However, I went to dinner that night with two friendly archaeologists who worked for PennDOT, our state's transportation authority. I didn't mention anything about the site, but when they asked why I was there, I took out the portfolio instead of talking. They saw the pictures and were genuinely moved. They couldn't wait to get back to the conference and share them with their friends. By the time the night was over, 20 or 30 people had looked at the photos, and most of them took them very seriously. Only a few people passed the stones off as glacial erratics without meaning or purpose. One of the professionals who got really excited about the photographs happened to be the Pennsylvania State Registrar for Archaeological Sites. She not only introduced me to plenty of people, but she suggested that I get this site registered as soon as possible. On Sunday morning of the conference, she pulled me aside and had a blank copy of an 8-page registration form printed out and ready to go. All I had to do was fill it in. However, she told me the form is set up to record sites that relate to small artifacts found in and under the ground. There was nothing on the form for a site like this one. So she took the time to counsel me on how to fill out the form line by line and to check off lots of boxes marked Other. She also gave me copious notes as to what text and additional photographs I would need to properly document this site. Over the course of the next week, I was on the phone with her several times as I completed the forms and an additional 33 pages of detailed documentation and photographs. I mailed my paperwork in on April 18th, and on May 10th, 2011, I had a document in my hands proclaiming that Council Rocks had been approved and assigned a site number of 36LU0306, so it's now on a national register. In December of this past year, I found what appeared to be a small coin with a metal detector. I called the state registrar for advice on who might help analyze it. She gave me a list of archaeologists and said I could choose one for my own liking. I called one from the list who asked me to bring the coin into his office and also asked where I'd found it. When I told him, he also asked me to bring documentation of the site. Upon seeing the photos and research, he went ballistic in a very good way. He was very open to the possibility of an archaeoastronomy site here and asked if I knew how big of a find this was. I said that I did, and I asked if he'd be interested in working on it. He said he would, and I was elated. However, since then he's been nearly impossible to get in touch with, almost elusive. I'm puzzled by that behavior, but I'm still hopeful. If not him, then someone else. This site eventually will be validated, professionally researched, and safeguarded. It's well on its way. I do believe that Council Rock Mountain is an ancient site, at least 4,000 years old, if not more, and constructed for the purposes of archaeoastronomy. I believe it contains many more mysteries yet to be revealed, and so I continue to listen to the spirits of the mountain that are revealing bits and pieces and asking to be kept sacred that which is to be kept sacred. I thank you all for listening and being here today, and I'll answer any questions at this time.